Today we're doing Reynolds number. Famous number, named after Reynolds, talks about fluid mechanics to do with Navier-Stokes equations.
But it's not one number, it's not like pi.
It's not, no. This is like the superhero version of pi, because pi is fixed. Pi has like one superpower, like circles and things. This is Reynolds number. This guy can morph and change to be whatever value it wants to be. But depending on what sort of size it is, whether it's really big or really small, you get different behavior with your fluid. So it's more like a label that you give to a particular situation. You have a fluid moving in some setup, and that's like high Reynolds number. It does one thing, but if you have the same fluid moving in a slightly different setup where it's now got a low Reynolds number, it does something completely different.
Like choosing your superhero from the Avengers.
If it needs to be invisible, it can be invisible. If it needs to reverse time, it can reverse time. It can do whatever it wants. Starting point, Navier-Stokes equations. So these guys model the motion, the flow of every fluid on Earth, in the universe, in fact. So we have these equations. They come from sort of universal laws of physics. We have masses conserved. We have Newton's second law. We get our equations. So we'll start by writing those guys down. We talked about these guys before and we did the full sort of what everything means, but we've got the top one, the little guy, which is conservation of mass. And then we have Newton's second law. I've made another slight simplification from the standard Navier-Stokes and I've said there are no body forces. Normally there's a big plus F here. We're gonna pretend there's not. That's the simple case. So here's our Navier-Stokes equations. Now we want to get the Reynolds number. So we need to define what the Reynolds number is. We label it with RE, and it's going to be our density rho times a length scale L times a velocity U divided by viscosity mu.
Tom, why do we even need a Reynolds number? These Navier-Stokes equations, which you've explained to us before, serviceable things for figuring out how fluids work. What was missing in the first place?
Here, so equation one is nice and simple. So we actually, that guy doesn't change with the Reynolds number discussion. But equation two, we've got like three bits. So we've got, use a different color. So we've got, this guy is acceleration because it's a density times a change in velocity. This guy is a pressure. And then this guy is viscosity. So viscosity is like an internal friction. Your layers of fluid sliding over one another and interacting. So we've got three bits. And the point is, in different situations, some of these bits will be more important than others. Practical example is, if viscosity was important when you go fast, you could clean your car by driving really quickly.
Like the air would just blast off the dirt.
Exactly. So if you have loads of little bits of mud all over your car and you just drove really fast, the air would actually wash it off because the friction in the air would grab onto the dirt particles, clean your car for you. So viscosity doesn't matter if you're going fast, it turns out, as we're going to see because of the Reynolds number. In some situations, they're all equally important. But in certain situations, like the extreme cases, you can get that one of them doesn't actually matter, or one of them is so important that it dominates the other two. And then you've got a nice, simpler equation, which we can then solve. Because as we know, we can't always solve Navier-Stokes. So if we can get our hands on this Reynolds number, allows us to simplify them and actually solve them and get somewhere.
So the Reynolds number is what apportions different weightings to the different factors.
Exactly, exactly. We can either have a really big Reynolds number or a really small Reynolds number. The sort of the standard thing we do in maths, let's consider if it's really big or it's really small.
And just so I've got some idea of what numbers you're talking about, are we talking like billions and negative numbers? Like tell us where they
are. So the Reynolds number has to be positive because it's a density times a length times a velocity over a viscosity. These are all positive physical things you can measure. And you plug those values in, you'll get a number. So it can be as small as sort of, you can go back down towards zero. So, you know, can't be zero, it can be just above zero. Or it can go as big as you want. But generally we're talking sort of 10 to 1,000 most everyday situations. If it's over 1,000, it's turbulent. So turbulence is this chaotic, crazy motion of fluids crashing into each other. So we have two cases of the Reynolds number. We've got big Reynolds number, so we say it's not just greater than one, it's much greater than one, so sort of 1,000 and above turbulence. And your equations, so we've got rid now of all of the sort of these guys, like the mu and the rho, they're in the Reynolds number now, so they're gone. And so what that means is you can start to compare your terms, and you end up with this guy, 1 over Reynolds squared. So if we compare this one to our original equation, we have the same terms. We've still got acceleration, we've still got pressure, and we've still got viscosity. But now we've sort of got rid of all the other little bits that were floating around, and now we can compare everything. Because by introducing the Reynolds number, what we've done is we've non-dimensionalized the system, which means get rid of the units. If I say I have 10 apples and I have 9 bananas, then if we consider apples, I have more fruit with my 10 apples than I do with my 9 bananas. But with my 9 bananas, I have more potassium than I do with my apples. The units matter. It depends. You can't say I have more apples than bananas. It depends whether I'm talking about fruit or potassium. The units are important. So now, by introducing the Reynolds number, what we've done is a non-dimensionalization, and we've got rid of units. So now we can compare acceleration, pressure, and viscosity. Three very different things with different units, but now they have no units. If the number associated with the acceleration term is bigger than the number associated with pressure, that means acceleration is bigger than pressure. It makes sense to compare them because they have no units anymore.
Okay.
This is the power of the Reynolds number, really.
Does the Reynolds number itself have units then?
The Reynolds number does not have units. The Reynolds number is just a number. And we can actually see that. So the Reynolds number itself is density times length times speed divided by viscosity. So let's think about the units. So
that's a real hodgepodge of units.
It is. So density, that's going to be kilograms per meter cubed. So we're in 3D. So we use the square bracket notation to denote units. For our length, well, that's just in meters. Our velocity, u, that's in meters per second. And then our viscosity, so this one is possibly less well known, but this guy is kilograms per meter per second. And now, if we plug them all together in the Reynolds number formula, we get the Re, the units. So on the top, we've got a density, so that's a kg m minus 3. Then we've got a length, that's an m. Then we've got a speed, ms minus 1. And then we divide through by viscosity, and now hopefully, we've done this right, kilograms cancel, meters minus 3 gives us meters minus 1, cancels seconds minus 1, seconds minus 1. So the Reynolds number has no units.
Brilliant.
So it is just a number, that's why it's called Reynolds number. It's just a number. It's why we can think about what happens when it's big and get this equation. So now the Reynolds number is really big. We've got acceleration equals pressure plus 1 over a really big number times viscosity. So 1 divided by a really big number is really small. So what's that telling us is that that guy doesn't matter. So in the situation of really large Reynolds numbers, which could be very, very light, very, very high density, very, very long fluids, or very, very fast fluids. So make this thing big however you have to. Viscosity doesn't matter. So you're driving your car, you're going really, really fast. That's why the viscosity of the air doesn't clean the dirt from your car, because you're in this large Reynolds number and your equations say viscosity doesn't matter. So it doesn't work. So what if the Reynolds number is now really, really small? We say it's much less than one. It's not just smaller than one, it's much less than one. And so what happens now with our equations is when we substitute this in, we do our non-dimensionalization the same way as before. But now we've got Reynolds number times acceleration equals the pressure term plus the viscosity term. So now it's slightly different to the one we had. So we've got Reynolds number, just a number, times acceleration is pressure plus viscosity. You might be wondering, why is the Reynolds number now here? Why is it on acceleration when before we had it over on viscosity? Now we have a small Reynolds number. And so in a small Reynolds number flow, we sort of know, we've done experiments to say that the pressure term is actually balanced by viscosity. Whereas in the big Reynolds number case, the pressure term is balanced by the acceleration. So that there is some slight difference in how you non-dimensionalize, but it still works in the same way. It still has units of pressure. You just have this choice between how to balance your pressure. So when the Reynolds number is small, we have this guy. So it's Reynolds times acceleration is pressure plus viscosity, but the Reynolds number is really, really small. So now I've got a tiny number times acceleration. So acceleration doesn't matter because Reynolds number is really small. So that now goes. So this is the term that doesn't matter in this small Reynolds number regime. So now just we've got pressure and viscosity, and that's it. Our governing equation is just pressure gradient plus viscosity. My favorite thing, I'm gonna say in all of fluids, is getting this result because we no longer have time in our equations. So we've started with Navier-Stokes, which we know are true. Mass is conserved, Newton's second law. That's a given. Then we've looked at small Reynolds number, and it turns out that in that situation, time vanishes from our equations.
Because the only thing bringing time to the table was acceleration.
Exactly. The only possible t in our equations was in the acceleration term. So now that's gone. That doesn't matter. I mean, it's still there, but it doesn't matter. It's everything else is bigger than it, so they dominate. So what that tells us is that when you have a small Reynolds number, time doesn't matter. So if you go forwards in time, and then you do the exact same thing backwards in time, and it has to be the same thing because the pressure and the velocity have to still be the same. But if you go forwards and then you go backwards, you should get back to where you started. You can literally time travel. You can time travel in a fluid because your Reynolds number is small and because time has vanished from your equation. So how do we get small Reynolds number? We've got density times length times velocity divided by viscosity. Let's make viscosity big. If we divide by a really big number, Reynolds number becomes small. A large viscosity means a very thick, sticky fluid. Let's take corn syrup, sugar syrup, your favorite type of syrup. It's very thick, it's very sticky, very large viscosity. So now we have a small Reynolds number. So let's see if we can do an experiment and get the same thing as we go forwards in time and then backwards in time, because the equations say it should work. Here is a cylindrical container filled with sugar syrup. We're gonna add 3 drops of food coloring. And then if we slowly turn this stirrer to mix the fluids together, we go forwards in time. So we'll do several rotations. And then stop. And as you can see, the blobs of food dye have mixed together, as you might expect. Now, if we do the exact same thing in reverse, so the same speed, the same pressure, everything the same, but we reverse the direction of our stirrer, we're going backwards in time. And as you can see, it's magic. Voila, we have gone back to the very beginning. We have gone, mixed them together forwards in time and then gone backwards in the exact same way and returned to our original state. And this works because time is not in our governing equations. So without Navier-Stokes, without Reynolds number, without this knowledge, we wouldn't know to even try this experiment. You wouldn't know to pick a really sticky fluid and see this awesome thing happening. But it is explained by the fact that time disappears from our equations. And that came from Reynolds number.
What's the bonus or the cool thing about a really big Reynolds number?
Big Reynolds numbers. So big Reynolds numbers just means super turbulent flow. So large Reynolds number is any kind of aerodynamics. Flow around a Formula One car, flow around a jet, that's large Reynolds number flow. And the issue with large Reynolds number flow is, well, turbulence. And turbulence we don't understand. Turbulence is one of the reasons we don't understand Navier-Stokes. And possibly one of the ways of getting that $1 million Millennium Problem Prize is by trying to actually come up with a theory for turbulence. So large Reynolds number flows, turbulence, very, very difficult. But fortunately, small Reynolds number flows make a bit more sense. And the sort of the intricate maths to it, or the key bit of the maths, is that when you have the small Reynolds number, as well as losing time, we lose time because we lose the acceleration term. But the acceleration term is non-linear. And so what that means is that's the difficult bit of Navier-Stokes. The reason Navier-Stokes are such a hard set of equations to solve is because they're non-linear. So that means if you have one solution, solution A, and you have a second solution, B, for a linear equation, A plus B will also satisfy that equation. But Navier-Stokes is non-linear, so when you do A plus B, you don't get a solution anymore. And that's because that's how we generally solve difficult partial differential equations. Difficult differential equations in general. We find one solution, find one that's similar to it, and keep adding them all together, and you get all of the solutions. But we can't do it because Navier-Stokes is non-linear. But it's only non-linear for big Reynolds number. If we take small Reynolds number, we've lost acceleration, we've lost time, we've lost non-linearity, and then we can actually solve it and get interesting solutions.
Unfortunately, that's not a very practical thing. That doesn't happen very often in the real world.
It doesn't, no. So Reynolds numbers, generally in the real world, like most things are turbulent. Right? If you just think the wind, the water in a river, in an ocean, it's most of our interactions with fluids are turbulent or are at least 100 plus on the Reynolds number scale. This kind of thing, getting rid of the nonlinear bit, getting rid of time, like you need much less than one. So you don't really see that in most of our world. You would on a tiny little like bacteria scale. You think about, you know, what's going on the really small cell, like individual cell scale, you might start to get small enough length scales in your Reynolds number that it'll become small. But in our world, unfortunately, we live in a turbulent world and we don't understand turbulence.
We live in a turbulent world, ain't that the truth?
Essentially means you need a bunch of positive charges here and a bunch of negative charges here, and then the things sort of fairly catastrophically re-equalize and the charges all balance out by a spark of electricity, essentially a current flowing from one to the other to make the thing all equalize out.